All right, we're rolling.
All right. First of all, thank you for coming to help celebrate Russell's life. First thing I'm going to start with is Russell's sister, Dale Warren, reached out to me just last week and said that Russell had asked her if there was a memorial, would she sing? And she had two songs that, or he had two songs she wanted her to sing. She wrote to me, I had to laugh when I remembered Russ asking for this song. It was the only thing he asked for. He said if there were to be any gatherings in his name, he would like this song played, adding, as only Russ could. If you don't know it, play any version but Josh Groban. I hate that motherfucker. So I learned it, ha-ha. Always inspiring others to learn to do some form or fashion. So here we go.
Thank you.
Turns out, Kid had a lead pipe stuck down his pants all the way past his knee, and he found it. The kid was a former gangbanger and was planning to get into a fight later that day. So he expelled this young man before he ever became an official student at Roscommon. But that was Russell. He understood. He could just sense when something was wrong, and he was there. He had a tremendous sense of humor, quirky, sometimes sense of humor. A lot of you will remember the incident with the tie and the shredder. A lot of you didn't get to see it, but Laura and I did get to see it with him walking out with the shredder holding on to his head. But after the tie thing, and he was able to reverse it and get his tie out of the shredder, he threw it away, and I don't know how many of you remember Pat Huddleston, science teacher, but Pat Huddleston had the ability to sneak into his office, pull it out of the trash can, and take it to her classroom, where she proceeded to hang it in her classroom for everyone to see. Then the next day, she had all of her students cut out little ties and bring them to his office and hand it to him one-on-one. Russell had a love-hate relationship with Ms. Huddleston. And that night, he decided, well, it's time to get her back. And so he printed out, she was doing frog dissection the next day. So he decided he was going to print out all these pictures of frogs, colored pictures of frogs, and then went in at night and pasted them all around the room. So while the kids were dissecting frogs, they could see these live pictures on the wall. But it was an ongoing back and forth battle. His other favorite thing to do was tell kids he could prove the existence of God, that he had a way to show them that God had existed with just two things, boogers and socks. And I heard him tell students this a million times, and finally I said, Russell, you gotta share with me this story. He said, think about it. The school was built in 1968. Think about the number of students that have come through here picking boogers and flicking them. This school would be buried in boogers if there wasn't a God to clean them up. Same thing with missing socks out of dryers. You know, where do they go? There's got to be a God. God is putting socks on the feet of the people in heaven that need them. It's the only explanation. So he always had this sense of, and then he used to play the dollar game. I don't know if any of you got to play the dollar game, but he would fold the dollar up and kids would have to hold their hand like this, and he would drop the dollar through their hand, and if they could grab it fast enough, they got to keep the dollar. Well, I didn't appreciate it much because then everybody came up to me and asked me, do you play the dollar game? And I said, no. But if you're hungry, I'll give you a dollar. And so I only gave $1 out, just like he did per day. But there are so many things that Russell did to help students. He loved all students, no matter what you were, no matter what kind of student you were. But his favorite were those that were missing something. He was the king moon racer of Prospect High School. And for those that don't know who King Moon Racer is, King Moon Racer is the king of the misfit toys in Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the lion that sits on the throne of the island of misfit toys. And that was Russell. He was the king of the misfit toys. The The train that had a caboose with square wheels. The bird that knew how to swim rather than to fly. The cowboy who rode the ostrich. Those were the kids that Russell really, really dealt with and was so powerful with. Those kids that had issues and needed somebody to be in their corner. And the reason I know this is because I am a misfit, and he was always there for me. He was always there to help me out. I didn't see much of Russell for the last 10 years. My son bought a house over in Santa Cruz when he lived over in Santa Cruz, and I kept saying when I would go over there, oh, I need to look Russell up. I need to go see him. I need to look Russell up. I need to go see him. But it always turned out there's a tomorrow. And then we come, and tomorrow doesn't necessarily come. But if I've learned anything, author Mitch Albarn wrote the famous book, Five People We Meet in Heaven. And it's based upon five people that we, had an important impact on our life. So I know one of my five people that I'll meet in heaven is Russell, because he had that kind of an impact on my life. And so maybe there is still tomorrow, and I look forward to being able to see him again. So I want to invite anybody that would like to take the time to come up and say something now.
Warren, that totally, you know, how you explained it, working with misfits, I was one of them. There's this one story, one teaching moment Mr. Warren gave to me. You know, I had a filthy mouth back in the day, and it got me in trouble. I was almost going to get in a fight with this one kid, Joseph Sanchez, which I'm sorry now. But, you know, I called him a fucking faggot. And as we know, Mr. Warren's also gay. And I got in trouble and got sent to the dean's office. And you know, instead of suspending me or locking me up, which I was hoping for, he made me write an essay. And at that point in that my life, I was like, man, it might as well be like death. I don't know. But he wanted me to write a 5-page essay on the Stonewall riots. And I hadn't heard anything about that, and I did my research. And if you don't know, the Stonewall riots are a period in the 60s in New York, where he was from, where there was being a lot of injustices for gays and lesbians. And they fought back, basically, and won. And to this day, I kind of reference back to that time in my life where Mr. Warren could have just sent me home, but that teaching moment was making me write an essay and making me learn about that. And you can best believe I don't think I ever used the word faggot in a derogatory term after that ever since. So that was just one of the many teaching moments of Mr. Warren for me. And after that, he fed me some peanut butter and jelly fried chicken that I've never even heard of. So that was Mr. Warren. So.
And got caught off campus on the office. I always ended up in his office, sitting there, and he'd always ask me why I'm doing things. I'd give him my, you know, I give him both opinions of why I was out there doing what I was doing. One was my funny, smart ass thing. He'd always pull it out of me what was going on at home. And all the things that, you know, a teenager's going through when, you know, their parents aren't really doing the best. So, you know, one of my favorite moments sitting in his office, I got sent there because I put on a red hat. And at the time, it was when I decided I hated the band with this. I don't know if anybody remembers that band. but it was a red hat, a red New York hat, and I wrote on it, "Fuck Predators" on it. And he was just like, what are you doing? I was like, everybody's got to know my opinion. I'm way more important than everyone else, obviously. You know, just being the smartest I am. And just sitting there, and he's just like, why would you even think about getting such a good hat? Because it was a New York hat. And writing on it. And then I turned it around, and it was a Yankees hat. And he was like, oh, I get it. Yeah. But all this time, you know, just end up hanging out with him. We really got to know each other personally. That extended outside of school, you know, the first couple years after I graduated. I was out doing my own thing. I ended up in Colorado. And I lived there on and off since 2006. But it was like right around 2010 where he started doing his baking and cooking and just being a goofball outside of work or outside of school, because I think he retired at that point, right? And I just started hanging out with him as an adult and sharing life. And he kind of like really put me back on track, even as an adult. More than one occasion. I ended up going to culinary school too, right around that time. And, you know, I run restaurants now. One of my favorite things about it though is in the last couple of years I came up and he was like, you want to smoke this joint with me? I was like, absolutely. You know, because at the end of the day, he saw what was going to happen in this world when it came to pain management. Psychology and psychiatry with the use of cannabis, you know, and we really connected on that because of my dad's last days, that's what he was using to stay, you know, keep food coming through his body and everything, you know, and it's just, I can't say that I would be where I am today without him, and, you know, I was that misfit too, 100%, he kept me, I could be so many different things right now. But if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be who I am right now today with so many people in influence. And I just want to continue taking his light and shining it on the world and doing exactly what he did. You know, it's a completely different industry, but I'm doing the same thing. I'm a GM of a restaurant now. I have all these kids under me, like 21, 22 years old, serving tables and cooking and everything. They're doing crazy shit still. It's like having these dumb kids were showing back up just to work, still hungover, still drunk, whatever, you know, and I'm just like, you know, this is going to happen, you know, but don't let this change everything for you, and just talk them through it. Now I got these kids running around, like, worried about going to bed at the right time, being in the serving job at 11 a.m., just so they can do a good job for me, and it just blows my mind. All because of work. Nobody else. Thank you.
Or something like that. But I've always crossed in between the lines of my girl and one that would go to college. And I remember always asking, like, why would they do that? Why would they throw their future away like that? And Mr. Warren would, you know, just hang out by the corner and say, like, it's a different type, it's a different life, it's a different experience. It was very zen. You don't know what someone else is going through, but sometimes you don't have to know. Sometimes you just let them go through it. And I didn't realize that all these things that he and Mr. Leeburn and all the educators in this room, how much it would stick to me and how much I would carry that forward in my own life and in my own career, working with university students and showing that there's much more to life than piece of paper, what you get on that piece of paper, what you bring home as a degree. It's who you show up as a person, as a human being, as a fellow jumble of atoms, is what I'd like to say. And he was always that person, again, alongside Mrs. Weaver, because I always remember you two were always right next to each other and sharing the good cop, bad cop, because one was not without the other, very yin and yang. And just knowing that no matter what I or my fellow students did, we would always be set back on the right track or the right path for us, not just as a collective, but be seen as an individual and be treated that way. Granted, I never spent much time in your offices. I do remember the one time I sped on Lawrence and a parent told on me, and that was the one time that I got in trouble. I was like, oops, never doing that ever again. One time I got called into the dean's office was for that. But I understood from that perspective that, from what you just mentioned, spending time in the dean's office, I wasn't given that perspective until I spent much more time with Mr. Warren. And being able to see that there isn't just one way to do school. It's learning outside the classroom as well. And I credit Ms. Warren for so much of that in my life. Even though we haven't seen much of each other since probably 2011, but that's always stuck with me. I've thought of him at least once a week every year just because of that. Again, all educators in the room, that's how you've impacted my life, at least, is always in my memory. And the teachings that you have outside of the curriculum really do stick. It sticks very deeply, and we remember. If anything, I hope that helps going through what the past couple years have been. And this award really has impacted me in that way, to be kinder to myself and to others who you don't know.
Yeah, let's go. Stacey Rader, I'm a teacher at Prospect, and I don't usually go to these things, so tells you how important he was. I know for a fact that I'm a teacher today because of him. I would never have made it to my first couple of years without Russell Warren. I am most definitely a misfit toy, and he recognized that, and I had some foibles in the beginning. Remember the first time that, well, we talked many times just because we had a similar sense of humor. But the first time I talked to him was after I called Ron the biggest fucking asshole at a faculty meeting. And I had to go to a anger management for that. And I remember, I was pretty upset. I pretty much thought I'd screwed up this whole new gig I was doing. I'd come from a small business, and I went into this, now you can't do that, right? You can't just pull up people and then think, we're cool, right? We're not cool, by the way. Pretty sure Ron Reed is still not cool with me. And I remember, he called me into his office, and I sat there in the chair, like one of the student's chairs, and he was talking to me, and he said, first off, I want to tell you, Ron Dominguez is a fucking asshole. Second of all, I want to tell you that you can't say that. That's not how it works. And we talked to them, and we talked talked about students and we talked about life, and you know, he had, he started the GSA and had me be the first advisor at the GSA, and you know, just life-changing stuff. I remember, you know, getting in trouble with him all the time. Like, we were outside one time to take this physical science class and teach it, and so I decided to be molecules. We're going to go out the quad, and we were going to do, there were going to be molecules, we're going to do phase changes, right? And so I'd be like, yes, and they'd run around, they'd bump into each other, all fall apart, and then I'd go liquid, they'd get a little closer, I'd go solid, and they'd slam together right in the middle of the quad. And I was like, what are you doing? And I said, phase changes, and I'm like, yes, and they all like started running all over the place, and of course they're screaming, and there's other classes going on, it's all inside, now. And all my kids just started marching. He just had that quiet power and that quiet presence, and he taught me how to be compassionate and empathetic and not get lost in this job and not lose yourself. You remember, you know, hard stuff happens to you guys when you're doing this job, and you know, he taught me how to like have empathy and stay soft-ish and but also be able to still do this job 22 years later. And I didn't see him much at the end, and I do regret that, but he is a huge part of who I am. So, thanks.
Thank you all. I remember that stoic face you could put and then just deliver the straight line right away. It was very impressive. Next, we're going to read a thing from Angie Warren, his sister-in-law. Thank you for loving and remembering Russell. He was truly one of a kind. Once he was under hospice care, we made a bucket list. He successfully completed every single item. For those who knew him well, you know Thanksgiving was his favorite day of the year. In true Russell fashion, he played the I'm dying card and suckered me into making his mother's homemade stuffing recipe. It takes 10 days for too many loaves of bread to grow stale, and then hours to prep the day prior. But we did it, and we had a wonderful holiday. Russell passed away on December 7, 2021. On his terms, at home, peacefully, showered in love. Christmas was bittersweet, but we decorated the tree in his honor. You see, he loved getting multicolored gel nails manicured during this time of year. The tree wasn't quite as fabulous as he was, but it did the job. The Warren family wishes you the happiest of New Year's as you continue to carry him in your hearts. We got one more song.
start playing in my hearing aids. too many Wi-Fi connections or Bluetooth connections. Something's gonna happen.
Hey, Mr. Leeburn, do you want to try, do you just need a hotspot for this? Or like an internet?
Yeah, let's see if this works.
Okay. That was awesome, Mr. Leeburn.
So thank you. That's Russell. We have refreshments. We got beer, wine, soda, water. Tuba, I don't know if you remember. I don't know what her current last name is. Sorry, Tuba. They own a restaurant called Q&Q. Barbecue in Mountain View. Please frequent it if you have the opportunity. They brought sliders and deviled eggs from their restaurant, and we have some charcuterie stuff, grapes, those kind of things. So please enjoy. I'll play a little music and reminisce. Thank you.